Hi there. I'm another fat bearded man talking about records, but as ever, you can, if you wish, call me Headley. I'm here today to talk country rock. Now, country rock is a genre of music I'm very passionate about. There's something about it, that sort of late 60s through the 70s sort of feel that really sort of attracts me. There's a relaxed feel to it. It's that very unpretentious. It has that one foot in the country realm and another foot firmly planted in the rock world. And I know that there are some records that have kind of made it through into the mainstream, that have become accepted in the rock pop world, especially the sort of stuff you see on the VC. So records like The Byrds, Sweetheart of the Rodeo, Flying Burrito Brothers, well, that's a bit shiny, isn't it? Flying Burrito Brothers, Gilded Palace of Sin, that's a great, great record, and you see it all the time. As is, more recently, the popularity of Michael Nesmith. This is his first album. In fact, people only seem to try and get the albums by the First National Band and him. But you're making a mistake. You need to get all of his country rock records. Even the Grateful Dead got in on the act. So they did a couple of albums that are very folky country, American Beauty being one of them. Obviously, the elephant in the room, I think, is probably the Eagles. One would have to say the most successful country rock band of all time. More esoteric stuff like Gene Clark, his debut album with the Gosdin Brothers after he left the Byrds. This is a kind of a hipster choice, I'd say, of country rock. He also did a couple of great albums with Doug Dillard. This is the first of the two, the fantastic expedition of Dillard and Clark. Great stuff and sort of records that you see shown in the VC. I've even seen the Beau Brummels, Bradley's Barn, a lot of bees in that, shown in the VC. Great, great record, played by some of the top Nashville pickers. And even something like The Band. I would say, can be described sometimes as being country rock. There's a rootsy feel to their stuff, which certainly means that they do have one foot in the country rock genre. So yeah, but I think you can see from all of those records that there's quite a diversity there. I mean, no one's going to say that The Band sound like the Eagles or the Eagles sound like Flying Burrito Brothers. There are obviously linking sounds, instrumentation, but also there's a diversity which means that actually country rock covers quite a wide spectrum of music. And so what I want to do in this video is to highlight some lesser known country rock records, which I think are great and I think should perhaps be more widely known and listened to. So sit down with me and enjoy some of these more off the wall country rock records. Okay, so the first one I want to show is this. This is the debut album by a band called Orphan, Everyone Lives to Sing, recorded in 1971, released in 1972. It's really the vehicle for sort of singer-songwriter Eric Lilliquist, who grew up in Massachusetts. He joined various bands in the late 60s. He started one called The Orphans, which were a kind of a psychedelic rock, garagey rock group that sort of played the Boston scene during the late 60s. They supported the Velvet Underground and various other rock bands. But by the time sort of the 70s rolled around, obviously the folk rock, country rock scene was taking off. And he met up with a guy called Dean Adrian, and they changed their name to Orphan. And this was I would say is at the folk rock end of country rock. No, over this side. Hands hurting. So it's a folky pastoral sound. It does have pedal steel guitar on it, so obviously it has that gives it a country rock feel in places. Very laid back, very hippie. Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young. You can hear that in there. Definitely an influence. You might know the name Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards was good friends with Eric Lindquist, and in fact he's on here. He played his vocals on one of the songs, and actually he would join the band later on, because Orphan would do two more albums after this, which are worth picking up and having a listen to. But yeah, as I said, this is the folk rock end of country rock, but really, really nice and really worth listening to.
Don't make excuses for a lonely day. All your feelings, you know they're just kidding. Take me closer to you. Don't go buying all those fantasies that they try to teach in school. You don't see me in my ugliness. You just see me in your...
Right, so next up, another band from the Boston scene, and that is this band, Country Funk. I've got to get my hand around like that. Country Funk. This was released in 1970 on Polydor. Like I said, they were from Boston. They recorded this through 1968 into 70, so it was sporadically recorded. And their name is not quite right. I mean, they're not funky, and they're not that country, but they are a kind of a Byrdesian psychedelic, maybe psychedelic with a small p, sort of Byrdesian, Buffalo Springfieldian. Could you say that? They have that sort of, maybe even early Poco, they've got that sort of feel. There's fuzzy guitars and some great harmonies, but at the core of it is a country feel to a lot of it. A really fine record. If you like the Byrds, especially some of their more psychedelic stuff with fuzzy guitars. Did they use fuzzy guitars? Yeah, from time to time. But yeah, it is a really fine album. I know someone that also thought it was a fine album because it was sampled by someone. In fact, I'll play a track that see if you can work out where the sample was used.
Somewhere else come winter time and I'm still free. Look at me. I live my life the way I please. I paid my price and now I see. But you're not for me.
Right, moving away from Boston, we've got Goose Creek Symphony. This is their album, their first album, called Established 1970, and it was released in 1970 on Capitol. Kind of an interesting sort of rural sort of country rock. It's rootsy, it's bluegrassy, it's got banjo and fiddle all over it. We've got a jaw harp on more than one song. I think, you know, the cover kind of tells you what to expect, really. They formed in 1968. There is a slight sort of sense of their music being slightly tongue-in-cheek. They are playing at being that sort of rural, hillbilly, if you forgive the term, cliche. They have that sort of element to their music, they actually came from Arizona. But Charlie Gerhart, who was the main guy behind it, he originally came from Kentucky, and he brought some of those his memories of the music from Kentucky with him. Actually, he had a career earlier as a guy called Richie Hart, and he had some rock and roll hits in the late 60s and into the early the late 50s into the early 60s. Anyway, so they would do a string of albums on Columbia from 1970 to 1976. They're all really worthwhile. They're really great stuff. Like I said, if you can get past the fact that it does have its tongue firmly planted in its cheek, you can probably really enjoy it. If you like your sort of rural, I mean, it has a kind of a sound of the band in places. It has that ruralness. That's not a word. But also you get some great big sort of psychedelic guitar solos alongside the jaw harp. So yeah, a really interesting band, Goose Creek Symphony. Okay, let's move to the kind of the home of country rock, the west coast of California, with this album, Maxfield Parrish. It's a cinch to give legs to old hard-boiled eggs. Interesting album cover. This was recorded in 1969, but not actually released until 1972, when the band had actually already split up. They take their name. Maxfield Parrish was an illustrator and artist, and they took his name. It was kind of born out of the 60s counterculture. Had this been released in 1969, I think this would probably be a bit higher regarded today. It would have been at the cutting edge of what was going on at the time, but by the time 1972 came around, it was a bit of old hat, really. They were influenced. I say they. It's basically David Biasotti and Perrin Muir, who were proteges of Jerry Garcia. They took musical lessons from him. They were big fans of the Byrds and Skip Spence with his album Or. They heard that. Probably some of the only people that did hear it when it was released. And so they were influenced by all these sort of various sounds coming out of the West Coast of California. They had a very literate approach with their lyrics, very classical, with influences from Byron, Shelley, that sort of thing. And unfortunately, the band themselves were not the greatest in the studio, and they had to look to sort of supplementing it with more skilled musicians, and they're on here. And in fact, this is produced by Chris Darrow from Kaleidoscope, and also it has his Chester Krill and David Lindley, who are also from Kaleidoscope, on that. If you don't know any David, any Chris Darrow stuff, oh, he's brilliant. I love him. But it's also on here, we've got Bernie Leadon from, oh, let's see, the Flying Burrito Brothers, the Eagles, Dillard and Clark Expedition, also Hearts and Flowers, so he had a hand in this as well. And you've got John London and John Ware, both of which were involved with various bands, including Michael Nesmith's First National Band. But this is a very sort of off-the-wall country rock record. It sort of really wears its heart on its sleeve from the 60s. It's that sort of sound. It is the best country rock album you haven't heard, unless you have heard it. And if you don't agree, it is the best. That you haven't heard. Well, anyway, you'll never know what's the best you haven't heard. But stop talking rubbish. A great. Apparently, when it was released, they wanted it to be a double album, and well, they took off some of the more psychedelic, weird shit that the band wanted to put on, so the record label weren't having that. What is the record label? Kernon. Not familiar with that label, but yeah, a really, really interesting record and one you should listen to.
Dart, the man that brings soft water, went upstairs and had an otter. Perhaps we'll notify his daughter if the lighthouse stops falling. Closed his ears to words we said, the 15th floor now on his head. Better off there, best off dead, as the lighthouse is falling.
Lighthouse is falling down, move so as to make no sound. Little children, they're all around, and the lighthouse is falling, and the lighthouse is falling.
Okay, so the last one I want to show is this. This is the Roslyn Mountain Boys. This is their debut album, self-titled, from 1976. Roslyn is in Virginia. And it's on the banks of the Potomac, across the river from Georgetown, Washington, D.C. I love the album cover because you've got this sort of very country-looking band, but in front of this quite urban landscape. And I think the name Roslyn Mountain Boys is a bit of a joke because I don't think there are any mountains in Roslyn. But this is the sort of record that it's far more towards the country end of country rock. If you like Gram Parsons' two solo records, you may well like this. If you like Emmylou Harris, in fact, I think Tony, what's his name? Tony Hannum played pedal steel for Emmylou Harris. They would become a backing band for various famous country music stars. And actually, I think this is a bit ahead of its time. It although it was released in 1976, it does have a kind of a slight feel of where Son of Nashville was going as you went into the 80s. And it's no surprise that the band was playing with Nashville players in the 80s. I think they called it quits in 1977. There is a second album released quite a bit later. They reformed. But if you like your country with a bit more country, sorry, if you like your country rock with a bit more country, this could well be the record for you. And if anyone's looking for something what to listen to after Gram Parsons, go for this. I hasten to add, I think that this might be the sort of record that Gram Parsons would have made had he still been making records in 1976. There you go.
I used to know two dying men. I hope that someone saves. Now the nighttime riders in the daylight digging the grave. I got a heaven hanging over me, waits for me to win. I don't know why I should be so afraid to begin. Me by, or did I just not see what was right before my eyes?
Okay, so that was the Roslyn Mountain Boys. That was a diverse bunch of records. Let me know which ones you liked, if you liked any of them, and if you'd like me to do some more of this. I mean, to be honest, I don't really mind what you say one way or the other, because I've got lots of country rock and I want to show them. So until I'm back, bye-bye for now.